so I'm going to be continuing the study that I've been working on today through next Sunday and probably a little bit beyond, the Conquest of Death. But today I want to introduce another theme that is going to be kind of riding alongside this going into next Sunday, and that is the theme of hope. Everyone needs hope, right? Amen. What happens if you lose all hope?
You will perish.
Yeah. So, where is your hope? What are you hoping for? What have you just about given up hoping for? I want you to listen to a couple of verses. When I came across these in my preparation, I'd already actually worked through most of this message and had come to a conclusion. And then I came across these verses, and it just took my breath away. It was so exactly what I wanted to say. It's Acts chapter 2, verses 25 and 26. Now, if you've already opened to 1 Corinthians 15, hold your place there, because we will be going back there. But these verses are just breathtaking. Acts 2, 25 and 26. This is Peter preaching on the day of Pentecost. And he said, "For David says of him, I saw the Lord always in my presence, for he is at my right hand, so that I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart was glad, and my tongue exulted. Moreover, my flesh also will live in hope." Now, all of those two verses are really fantastic, but what I want to underline, if you will, is the first phrase where it says, "I saw the Lord always in my presence." And just think about that for just a minute. I saw the Lord always in my presence. And then the last phrase, "My flesh also will live in hope." Do you see a connection between those two ideas? I saw the Lord always in my presence. My flesh also will live in hope. It doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure out how those things connect together, does it? All right, so what I want you to do is to just kind of take that thought and put it in your pocket, and then we'll get it back out towards the end of this message, and I think you'll see that it's going to tie together really well. So now we're going to go to 1 Corinthians 15, and we're going to pick up where we left off last week. As I told you before, in this passage, we are looking at a place where Paul, in his writing, he was going along on a certain subject, and then he wrote this phrase, and that made him decide to chase a rabbit for just a little bit, and he then spent the next seven verses expounding on this phrase, but what he had been talking about was the fact that somebody at the church of Corinth was teaching that there really was no literal resurrection. And his argument for that was, if there's no literal resurrection, then Jesus hasn't been resurrected either, and therefore our faith is in vain. And so, what we're going to look at today is kind of like an overarching view of the resurrection. It is not detailed, but it is full of some really dynamic truths. So Paul is in this what-if scenario. What if there is no resurrection from the dead? And then in verse 20, he stops all that what-if talk with facts. Josh McDowell said that when he was challenged by some Christians to examine for himself the truth of the claims of Christ, he said he thought they were a bunch of morons, and he said he didn't realize there were facts. And so Paul is doing now is he's making a statement that he's already backed up with facts and that he will continue to again. So, end of the what if, Christ has been raised, there is a resurrection. That's verse 20. But now Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who are asleep. Now, that phrase, "the first fruits of those who are asleep," that is the phrase that he's going to expand on over the next seven verses. And then, as we saw last week, when he's done, then he comes back to the original subject. The first fruits was a special sacrifice that was offered by the Jewish people right at the beginning of harvest. The first of the harvest, the very first of the harvest, was brought and offered as a particular sacrifice to God. And it was assumed that if they were faithful to bring the first of their harvest and give it to God, that He would be faithful then to provide a bountiful harvest thereafter. So it was really, it was an act of faith, a lot like the act of faith that we do when we give today. We give trusting God that He is going to provide everything we need after that. So the first fruits was the very first with a lot to follow. That's the idea that Paul's going to be carrying through here. The very first with a lot to follow. When he said that Christ is the first fruit of the resurrection, that's the idea that he was wanting to give. The illustration is that Christ was the first, the source, the fountainhead of resurrection, and that all the rest of it would be from him and through him. Now some of you may be thinking, but wait a minute, weren't some people resurrected before Jesus? Yes, there were several, as a matter of fact. There were some in the Old Testament. There were some in the New Testament. But there is a difference between those people and what we're going to call the resurrection. We say that those people were resurrected, but they were not part of the resurrection. Now let me explain the difference. The resurrection, not only are people coming back to life, but they're coming back to life in new, glorified, completely perfect bodies that cannot die, that cannot sin, that cannot err, that cannot get sick. I'm assuming we won't even get tired. They're going to be perfect bodies, like Christ was when he was resurrected from the tomb. Amen. But all those other people, like the widow's son and Nain and Lazarus, we assume that they all, even though they were brought back to life, they died again because they weren't brought back to life with this glorious immortal body that we're going to have then. And so, at least I assume that if Lazarus was still walking around down on this earth somewhere, he hides his age very well. I did see a guy in Walmart the other day that looked like he could just about be that old, but but anyway, that's the difference between their resurrection and the resurrection. So Jesus was the first one to experience the resurrection, because he was resurrected with that nature, that new body like we are going to have, excuse me, that we'll have one of these days. I'm assuming that our body won't be as glorious as Jesus' body will be, but it will be like it. It will be of the same nature. And those bodies will last forever and ever. All right, we continue. Verse 21. For since by a man came death, by a man also came the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ all will be made alive. These verses continue the description of the way that life and death are passed on. Now, some people view this as symbolic only, but I am strongly convinced that this is literally true, both in a spiritual and in a physical sense. And I think whenever I explain it, that you'll agree with me. The first man, Adam, sinned. And therefore, death came upon the entire human race. Why? Why is it that what that turkey did gets me in all this trouble? Well, it's for this reason. When Adam sinned, he fell, and as a fallen man, he could only sire fallen children. Mm-hmm. And Eve, as a fallen woman, could only give birth to fallen children because the nature was changed. And so that's exactly what happened generation after generation after generation, all the way down to you and me. We are all descendants of Adam, therefore we were in Adam, and when he died, we died. Let me back this. If this is confusing, I'm going to go from a slightly different angle here, and I think that you'll get it. It's not that hard to comprehend, but when the Human Genome Project was completed, when it was in progress, evolutionists expected to find that different races evolved from different lines of human evolution. In other words, they thought that while there was one subhuman being evolving in Africa, then in Asia there was another subhuman being evolving, and in Europe there was another subhuman being evolving, and all these things were taking place. And what an accident that all of those different lines of evolution ended up being humans. Isn't that just totally amazing? So, I mean, actually, if you think about it, that kind of logic is even lower than the primates they claim we came from. It's lower than childish, if you think about it. Because how is it that different, completely different lines of evolution could all come up with humans? Well, when they completed the Human Genome Project, the overwhelming conclusion of that is that we all came from one set of parents. There's no races. There's only one race, and that's the human race. We all came from one set of parents, who happened, by the way, to be a man and a woman. Now, the reason I say all this is so that you will understand that you yourself are a direct descendant of Adam and Eve, and you are said to be in Adam because when Adam and Eve were producing children, all of the potential for reproductive generation after generation lay right there in Adam and Eve. And so the potential for the entire human race, we're all descendants. That's why it said we are in Adam. Because the potential for you was physically present in Adam. In Adam, all die. When Adam died, you die. Adam's physical death guarantees your physical death in Adam. However, just as there was reproductive potential for your birth in Adam, there was also the spiritual reproductive potential for your rebirth in Christ. Amen. Just as Adam gave rise to fallen people, Christ gives rise to resurrected people. So the very same concept, this is Paul is putting these two concepts side by side, saying they're same. In Adam, which had the potential for all of humanity, in Adam all died, and then in Christ, which had the potential for all of those who would be reborn by faith, in Christ all were made alive. Some people think that this verse is saying that every human is going to be made alive. In Christ shall all be made alive. But that's not what it's saying. It's saying all in Christ shall be made alive. So your spiritual rebirth, your salvation, it was all bought with a price, and it was all there in Christ Jesus. And so, just as we say that physically we are in Adam, then if you are a believer, a born-again believer, then spiritually you are in Christ. Amen. And therefore all of those things that are true of Christ is going to be passed on to you in a spiritual generation sort of way. As one generation teaches another generation about Christ and younger ones begin to have their eyes opened, and the Lord comes and moves in their hearts, and they say, yes, yes, this is true, and they become believers, then that continues on and on. So the resurrection process has already begun in your life. Now, if you're as old as me or older, you probably don't feel like it. I figured I'd get some amens or some omies or something on that. Just a few sighs around the building. But it has. The resurrection process has already begun in your life. We're at verse 23. But each in his own order. All right, so the resurrection process is already at work, but each in his own order. Christ, the first fruits. After that, those who are Christ at his coming. All right, so really that verse is kind of summarizing what we've just said. Christ was the first with a whole, the first fruits, the first with a bountiful number to follow. And then it says, after that, and when is the resurrection of the dead in Christ? Your lost loved ones that went on to be with the Lord, when is it that that resurrection takes place? At his coming.
Amen.
At his coming, at his parousia in the Greek. All right? So, Christ the first fruits, and then those at Christ's coming. Now, before I go on with this passage, let me just kind of put on the brakes and talk to you for a minute about the millennial reign of Christ, because you're going to want to know a little bit about that when we get to the next part of 1 Corinthians 15. I'm going to talk to you about this thousand-year reign that will happen out there in the future. At the end of the future seven-year tribulation, there will be a battle in which all the forces of Antichrist and his enemies are going to join together to try to do battle against the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. John saw Jesus coming on a white horse, and he saw us following him on white horses, because we'll be with Jesus already at this time. And so Jesus is going to come, and all of those armies are going to turn their weapons and turn their attention to try to defeat Jesus, and he is going to destroy them in judgment. Jesus, he will carry out judgment against the beast, the false prophet, all who follow them. The Antichrist will be cast into the lake of fire, and Satan will be locked into the bottomless pit, and Jesus will begin his personal reign on earth, ruling the world from Jerusalem. Now, that's the last we see of Antichrist, but it's not the last we see of Satan. We'll see that in just a minute. So I'm going to read some verses from Revelation 20 that kind of summarize what we're saying here that John saw at this time. Then I saw thrones, they sat on them, and judgment was given to them. And I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded because of the testimony of Jesus and because of the word of God, and those who had not worshipped the beast or his image, and had not received the mark on their forehead and on their hand. And they came to life and reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. The rest of the dead did not come to life until the 1,000 years were completed. This is the first resurrection. Blessed and holy is the one who is a part in the first resurrection. Over these, the second death has no power. But they will be priests of God and of Christ and will reign with him for 1,000 years. There are some very well-meaning and sincere Christians today who would tell you that this passage is just symbolic, that there is no literal 1,000 years, and that we are actually in the millennial reign today. That point of view is called amillennialism. I don't believe that, and there are several reasons to reject it. The chief reason being that this passage that we just read in Revelation is not written in the kind of language that can easily be taken as symbolic. This is a rule that you need to remember as you study your Bible. When the scripture is going to speak symbolically, there are clues in the text that is speaking symbolically. We do not have the liberty to just go in and take any passage that we want to and say, ah, oh, that's just symbolic. Because there are going to be clues in the text for that, and there's not any clues in this text that that is only symbolic. And then when you add in all the other information concerning God's promises to Israel and the descriptions of this time period in the book of Isaiah, it becomes quite clear that this is literal. So we call that the premillennial view, which means that Jesus will come before the thousand-year reign. So, what is this thousand-year reign all about? Do you remember last week when I made the comment that the resurrection is when all of our fondest hopes and dreams come true? Well, the thousand-year reign is when all of Israel's fondest hopes and dreams come true. Christ will rule from Jerusalem over the entire world, as the Bible says, with a rod of iron. Now that does not mean that Jesus is going to be cruel. It just means that he is going to enforce his law. Amen. He is not going to tolerate rebellion against it. There will be no picketing of Jerusalem. There will be no activist judge to come along and say that Christ's law is unconstitutional. Amen. His word will be the law of the world, and he will not tolerate rebellion against it. And there are some clues, I'm going to show you a couple of them, that there will be enemies of Christ during the tribulation, during the millennial reign. I don't know if you've ever thought of that before. You would think that there would be no enemies of Christ during the millennial reign. I mean, after all, the earth is going to be transformed into a paradise like has not been seen since the Garden of Eden. You would think, with all of the wonderful things that are going to happen during that time period, that people would understand. But even then, there are going to be a few people, some people, who are enemies of Christ during that time. All right? So, one of the clues is what we're about to read from 1 Corinthians, and the other is that at the end of the thousand years, Satan is going to be released from the bottomless pit. Now you're probably thinking, why would God do that? Well, what Satan is going to do is he is going to go over the world and he's going to find those people who are not faithful to Christ. It may be that they are in hiding. It may be that they are covering up. But he's going to search out and define, and he's going to deceive those people into joining forces with him in an attempt once and for all to overthrow Christ and to overthrow God. This occurs at the end of that thousand years. And the Bible tells us that fire is going to fall from heaven and consume them. And then we enter into the eternal state described in Revelation 21 and 22, where we will be, and where will we be during all that time? The thousand years? Well, we'll have already received our resurrection bodies, and we're going to be part of Christ's ruling administration during all that time. So, there's a lot to happen between now and then, right?
Right.
But with that in mind, let's go back now to 1 Corinthians 15 and just see this very general overall overview of what he's saying. So once again, in verse 23, he says, "But each in his own order, Christ the first fruits. After that, those who are Christ and his coming." Now, what I want to do here is I'm going to read several verses. And rather than read the entire passage and then turn around and try to explain it, what I'm going to do is I'm going to, in place of some of the pronouns that are in this passage, I'm going to use the actual name of the, I believe that's called the antecedent. Just want to impress you with my knowledge of grammar, see? I'm going to clean myself off after I say that word. But anyway, so rather than say the actual pronoun that's written, I'm going to say the actual person that the pronoun's referring to. And I think that just doing that will be enough to cause everything to fall into place. All right? So, then comes the end, when Jesus hands over the kingdom to the God and Father, when Jesus has abolished all rule and all authority and power. For Jesus must reign until he has put all enemies under his feet. The last enemy that will be abolished is death. Now, we were talking about people who were Christ's enemies, but there are also conditions, laws of nature in the world that are going to be considered Christ's enemies. And even death itself is going to be abolished. Revelation tells us that death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. Yes, indeed. So, going on. For the Father has put all things in subjection under Jesus' feet. But when the psalmist, the writer of the psalm that he's quoting, when the psalmist says all things are put in subjection, it is evident that the Father, he is accepted, who put all things in subjection to Jesus. In other words, God put all things in subjection to Jesus. Jesus overcame the world and he put down all rebellion against him, and he completely overcame all opposition because the Father gave him rule over that. But he's saying it is obvious that God the Father did not put himself under the subjection of Jesus. He put everything else. So it is evident that the Father is accepted and put all things in subjection to Jesus. When all things are subjected to Jesus, then the Son himself also will be subjected to the Father, the one who subjected all things to him, so that God may be all in all. Now, does that kind of help you understand what all that is? All right. So God the Father, he put the entire universe into the hands of Jesus, and Jesus, during his 1,000-year reign, he subdued all other rule and authority, and he completely conquered it all. And now everything belongs to Jesus and is under his authority. And then Jesus, then at that time, puts himself, as well as everything else, under the authority of the Father. Now, this is not saying that Jesus is inferior to the Father. Jesus said on more than one occasion, I and the Father are one. And so we need to avoid thinking, as far as the Trinity is concerned, we need to avoid thinking too much on the three side. And again, we've talked about this before. God is one God. He's three in one, Father, Son, and Spirit. We are three in one people. We are soul, body, and spirit. Amen. But there's just one of us, right? But we can clearly delineate between the soul and the body and the spirit. I mean, I can definitely make a distinction between my mind and my body. So, we are three in one. And so, in an infinite, much more infinite way, God is three in one. He's Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So, it's not like Jesus is inferior to God because Jesus is God. He is the body of God. When Jesus was on the earth, he was the physical body of the omnipresent God. It is. Okay? So it's not like that Jesus is putting himself down. It's just that he's taking his rightful position. You know, our bodies are subjected to our minds. Or at least, it's supposed to be that way. My body doesn't always do what my mind tells it to these days, but it's supposed to be that way. And so Jesus is just taking his role in the Trinity, the second person, subjected to the first. The Son is subjected to the Father. So the glory does not belong to just one of the three persons. It belongs to all of them as one God. Now, I'm going to, I just love this. Now, you all know that I have studied a little Greek, but I'm a long ways from being a Greek scholar. But God put my attention on those three words, all in all. And I probably researched the Greek on that for about 45 minutes. If Larry Franklin were here, it would have taken him 30 seconds, but it took me 45 minutes. But it was worth it. This is what I came up with. So I'm going to give you my unofficial Simpson translation in just a minute. But the root words for the first all and the second all, those are the same root words, but the case is different. Now, if you forgot what case is from your high school years, well, you're just goner, and it's just figured all that. But the case is a part of grammar, and Greek case is similar to, but is not exactly the same as English. So let me just tell you that the first all is in the nominative case. The second all is in the Greek dative case. So even though it's the same root word, there's a little shade of difference between the meanings of those words. Now I'm gonna cut through all the stuff that I came across, and I'm just gonna go ahead and give you the unofficial Simpson translation of that. And here it is. So that God may be everything, everywhere. So that God may be everything, everywhere. Again, that's not to be taken in a pantheistic way, but a way to say that forever and ever, God is the focal point of this entire universe. God, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, He's everything, everywhere, and throughout eternity, He will be the focus of the entire universe. He will be all in all. Right now, people are sitting in churches all over the country, and they're asking questions. A lot of people that are sitting in church right now around the country, they came, and they have many reasons for being there. Some came because they want to know how God can heal their marriages. Some want to know God's will for their lives. Some are in church this morning seeking deliverance from addictions. Some have become so completely broken by life that they do not know where to turn. Some are seeking physical healing. Some are seeking intervention in their children's lives. Some are seeking intervention in their parents' lives, for that matter. And some just want to have some assurance that life matters. I have not given you all the answers to all those things today, but what I have and am giving you is the idea that must become the basis for every answer to the questions that we have to ask. We must look to God for who He is and to reach out to Him by faith, which produces love. What does it mean to keep your eyes on God? What does it mean to keep your eyes on God? Let me put this back up here again. This is that we started with. I saw the Lord always in my presence. How do we see God? Have any of you ever seen Him?
By faith you see Him.
All right. Let me ask you this question. This is going to lead us right to what Charles just said. In the spirit world, in our spiritual experience, what takes the place of sight? We walk by blank, not by sight. Faith. Faith takes the place of sight. Now, my physical eyes have never seen God. So how can David say, I saw the Lord? How can we say, I see the Lord always in my presence. Because we are actually making the choice to reach out and touch God with faith. How many of you came today hoping for a touch from God? How many of you came today thinking that you could give God a touch? We don't think of that as much, do we? But we can. We can give God a touch. And the way we do that is to, in our minds, think of Him. And I don't know what kind of an image you may have in your mind when you think of Him. Generally, if I'm going to pull an image into my mind, I think of Christ as He is depicted in the first and the fourth and the fifth chapters of Revelation, particularly the first one, when He first appeared to John, and He was glorious, and His robe was shining, and His eyes of fire, and His head were white with light, and His feet were like shining bronze. That's usually the picture I think of when I draw an image of God into my mind. But sometimes I just see the words Father, Son, Holy Spirit. It doesn't really make that much difference as long as your image is scriptural. But when you draw that in your mind and you say, God, I believe that. I believe You. And so by faith, I see. And what do I see? I see the Lord always in my presence. That means I am choosing to believe by faith that You are always with me, that all of Your promises come true, that You never leave me or forsake me. You are always there. And so then what is the consequence of that? It is my flesh or my body also will live in hope. Hope. You find hope when you see the Lord always in your presence. And you see the Lord always in your presence when you choose to believe His Word. Isn't that amazing? That's breathtaking to me. To focus on the resurrection is to remind ourselves that this is what the world is coming to. Have you ever watched the news and or just asked yourself, what is this world coming to? It may not look like it right now, but believe it or not, we're right on schedule. We are. God has never set back, not even a minute. And everything that is happening today with all of its craziness and the perversion of truth was predicted in the Scripture. It is all on God's schedule. It is marked on His calendar and part of His eternal plan to produce the future world that we have looked at today. God is never set back. The resurrection promises us that the world to come is where the world is headed to. Where else would we want to put our eyes with such great promises for the future?